before we go any further, let me address the elephant in the room. Pastor Martin's not here this morning. He and Sister Martin are out of town. They're in New York City spending time with family and celebrating their 37th wedding anniversary. Praise the Lord for that, 37 years. We hope they're having a great time, and we pray God's traveling grace and mercy for their safe return. Pastor Martin's not here, but there's a pretty good chance he's watching on live stream. So everybody say, hey, Pastor Martin.
Hey,
Pastor Martin. Hey, Lady Deborah. Hey, Sister Martin. Praise God. As Pastor Martin would say here at True Light, you never know what you're going to expect. It's like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get. But you ever reach into one of those boxes of chocolate and pull out one, and it looks so good, and you think it's something, and you bite into it, it's like, oh, that's not what I wanted. You wrap it up first, then put it back for the next person. That's what happens sometimes when people come to service and they see that Pastor Martin's not preaching. They quickly spit it out. Jerry talked about your expectations. If you came expecting to see Pastor Martin, you're gonna be disappointed. But if you came to feed on the Word of God, you will be filled. Praise God. Praise God. You just happen to have that piece of chocolate and nuts in it for you today, in front of you today. The karma. The Word of God is good. The Word of God is powerful. And the Word of God is the living Word. So hopefully we will come and feed on this Word today. And I pray that as the Word goes forth, it is planted on fertile ground. Because this is some good stuff, to be honest. And I told Sister Jerry after she got done with Sunday school, I said, you know, you don't realize it, but you gave me confirmation in what you taught this morning about what was given to me for this sermon today. All right, well, if it's okay with you, we'll jump right into our scripture passage for this morning. All right. With your Bibles in your hand, please stand in reverence for the reading of God's Word. And turn with me to the Old Testament book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings. And we'll be going to the 17th chapter of 1 Kings. First Kings chapter 17, and we'll be looking at verses 8 and 9. 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 8 and 9. Everyone there? Praise God. And the word of the Lord came to him. Arise. Go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. The word of God, for the people of God, and may God add a blessing to read and hear his word. Please be seated. As I am sometime apt to do, this morning I will share a story with you that has some relevance to our scripture reading this morning. One day a mouse looked through the crack in the wall to see the farmer and his wife open up a package. What food must this contain, thought the mouse. And then he was devastated to discover it was a mouse trap. So the mouse ran to the farmyard. He's proclaiming the warning. There's a mouse trap in the house. the chicken clucked and scratched her hand, she said, "Mr. Mouse, I can tell this is a grave concern to you, but it is of no consequence to me. I cannot be bothered by it." So the mouse went to the pig and said, "There's a mouse trap in the house. There's a mouse trap in the house." The pig sympathized, but said, "I'm very sorry, Mr. Mouse. There's nothing I can do about that but pray. Be assured, though, you are in my prayers." So the mouse turned to the cow and said, "There's a mouse trap in the house. There's a mouse trap in the house." And the cow said, "Mr. Mouse, I'm sorry for you, but that's no skin off my nose." So the mouse went back to the house, head down, dejected, to face the farmer's mouse trap alone. That very night, a sound was heard throughout the house. Sound of a mouse trap catching its prey. The farmer's wife got up to see what was caught, and in the darkness, she could not see that it was a venomous snake whose tail had got caught in the mouse trap. The snake bit the farmer's wife. The farmer rushed her to the hospital, returned home with her when she had a fever. Got home. Well, this farmer is one of those who held the notion that you treat a fever with fresh chicken soup. So he took his hatchet and went out to the farmyard, got the chicken, killed it, served his wife fresh chicken soup. But his wife's sickness continued. So friends came by to visit, many friends, around the clock. So to feed them all, the farmer had to butcher the pig. The farmer's wife did not get well. She died. And many people came to her funeral. So many people that the farmer had to slaughter a cow to provide enough food to feed all of them. The mouse looked upon us with great, and from the crack in the wall with great sadness. So the lesson of the story is, next time you hear someone that's facing a problem or think it doesn't concern you, remember that when one of us is threatened, we can all be at risk. See, we are all involved in this journey called life together. And we must keep an eye out for each other and make an extra effort to encourage one another. Each of us is a vital thread in another person's tapestry. So we should always look out for the other person. Praise God. We are supposed to give our sermons titles. So this morning the title would be, "What'd You Call Me?" And the word of the Lord came to him, "Arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow to provide for you." The hymn the verse refers to is Elijah. And before we go any further, let me tell you what Elijah means. There's meaning to names in the scripture. The meaning of the name Elijah is, "My God is the Lord." In the 17th chapter of 1 Kings, Elijah bursts into the scene, seemingly out of nowhere. You're reading, all of a sudden, Elijah's there. The scene was not a good one. The nation was in spiritual and moral decline and in rebellion against God. That's right. And they're under the rule of King Ahab. Now, each king the nation had was wicked up to this point. Every king was in succession, they were wicked. But the Bible says that King Ahab did what was evil in the Lord's sight, even more than any of the kings before. So he was the one, he's the worst king they had. So Elijah burst on the scene, and he comes before the Lord, and he says, "As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, whom I serve, there will be neither dew nor rain in the next few years except at my word." Okay, this is Elijah addressing the king. As Stephen A. Smith would say, Elijah was a bad man. He was a man of God. He was a servant of God. He was a prophet. He was a miracle worker. He was a preacher, and so on and so on. And the Bible tells us in the fifth chapter of James that Elijah was a man of like nature to us. He was just like us. And that should be a great encouragement to all of us, because sometimes we read in the Bible about the people and we think they were just so super spiritual. We think they were just so extraordinary, but just regular, ordinary, flawed, imperfect people like you and me. They did extraordinary things because they served an extraordinary God. And because they served an extraordinary God, he can do extraordinary things through, in them, and through them. Now, we have the same access to the same God and the same extraordinary power that the people in the Bible have. Okay? We got to understand it is an honor and it is a privilege to be used by God. We have to understand that it is not the vessel, but God in the vessel that demonstrates the power. In 2 Corinthians 4:7, Paul writes, "We have this treasure in jars of clay to show this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us." The clay jars represent our human frailty, our unworthiness. The clay jars had little beauty and did not attract attention to themselves. It's the treasure that's within the clay jars that's valuable. It's not us, it's what's in us. The clay jars can't do anything. The extraordinary, all-surpassing power of God is not from us. And we should not take pride in being used by God. We should be amazed that God would even choose to use us. We should be humbled and incredulous that he would even think to use us. We have a tendency to get, we allow ourselves to get so puffed up and we get that big head and we think we have something to do with it. Right? Instead of using us, instead of God using us, we make it about us. We like to come and say, "Man, did you see what I did in front of the king? Did you hear what I did? Man, I told him it ain't gonna rain until I say so." Well, what'd the king say? He couldn't say nothing. Don't he know who you're messing with? Man, weren't you scared going between that evil king? No, I wasn't scared. The Bible says I can do all things. Notice, I can do all things. A little success can go to our head. And now, because we had a little success, we really want to serve God. We turned up. I'm called. And I can do all things. So now I want to be on this ministry. I want to be in, I can barely count to four, but I want to be on the finance team. All right? Because I'm called. I can't boil a pot of water, but I want to be on the kitchen ministry. I can barely hear, but I want to run the sound ministry. I don't even like people, but I want to be on the greeters ministry. Because I'm called. I can do all things. I want to preach, and I want to teach, and I want to do this, and I want to do that. Because I'm called. I was a kid, so I should be in the children's ministry. Because I can do all things. Thank God for his word. Thank God for the word. We can learn so much. This word teaches us so many lessons. So let's look and see what happens next. In the scripture, and the word of the Lord came to him, saying, go from here and turn east and hide yourself at the brook Cherith, east of the Jordan. You shall drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. So he did according to the word of the Lord. He went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, east of the Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. After a while, the brook dried up because there was no rain in the land. People tend to think or complain about how hard it is to hear God's leading, how hard it is to know what his purpose is for them. And some people question whether God can even speak to them. The problem is not God's leading. He's always ready to lead us and guide us. The problem is our listening. See, God is never the problem. We are. Too often our listening is colored by false expectations and selfish motives. We want the Lord to speak to us, but we want the Lord to tell us what we want to hear and how we want to hear it. We want the Lord to lead us, but we want him to lead us where we want to go. We want to do our will, and then we take that to the Lord, ask his blessings on our will instead of seeking his will for our lives. We have in our minds how we want our lives to go, what we want to do, and how we want to serve, instead of seeking his will and his way. But man's tendency is to direct his own way, to go where he wants to go. That's our nature, to do things the way we want to do it. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, and in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Anybody need a straight path? Amen. Amen. So the Lord says, go hide yourself by the Cherith Brook. Remember, the names of the scripture are important. They're significant. Cherith is the Hebrew Cherith, which means a cutting. A cutting. I'm going to throw it in now because it's going to come into play a little bit later on in this lesson, in our sermon. The Cherith Brook is isolated, desolate, away from everything. We'd say it was in the middle of nowhere. Elijah heard the word, he obeyed, and he went. And for some of us, it might look like a waste of time. Why is he going out to Cherith? Here he is. This is the nation's foremost prophet out in the middle of nowhere. How is he going to address the king in his court? How is he going to lead a spiritual revival? Way out there. We got a leader with no one to lead and a preacher with no one to preach to. Doesn't make any sense. Because we like to do and do and do and go and go and go. I'm called, so I gotta go do this, I gotta do this, I gotta go, I gotta go, I gotta go, I gotta go. And we're doing our own thing instead of listening for the word of the Lord. always on the go. So many things to be done and to get done. I gotta serve. I gotta get this done for the Lord. I gotta do it for the Lord. I got no time to be out there in the chair to wait for everything. I gotta do. What happens is we get so focused on the call, we lose sight of the caller. To be used by God is so exciting, it's so exhilarating, it's so energizing, and it's so fulfilling. Of course we want it. Of course we want it. But there's a greater need, and that's to meet with God, to spend time with God. It's the greater need to linger in His presence. We need time alone with God, away from all the hustle and bustle of daily life. We need time alone with God, away from your workplace, away from your family, away from your friends, away from your ministry. Quiet time with God. And it's not easy for us because we're all so used to the noise of life. And we're so used to the busyness of life. It's a commercial on TV Lab on right now. I saw it a couple weeks ago. It's a young couple, and they're out laying a tent out in the woods, and they said, "We finally did it. We finally went camping." And they land there at night, and it's quiet. And it was too quiet for them. And they're so used to it, so they turn on the sounds of the city so they could be comfortable. So they're out in the woods, but they turn on the sounds of the city just because they're used to. We have to shut off the noise of the city, the noise of life. And in the quietness and the stillness, spend time with God. Psalm 46:10 says, "Be still and know that I am God." We have to be deliberate about it because we're not used to doing it. We're used to going. We're used to being active, and we're used to doing it. So we have to be deliberate and be still. We had a foster child, our first foster child that came to us, and he was hyper, man. He was just so full of energy. He was hyper. Everywhere. And the worst thing to do to him was to have him sit down and be still. He could not stand. Couldn't stand it. It would drive him crazy to have to sit still. And we're the same way. We don't want to sit still. We have to get to that place. Away from everything else. In this presence. Just to worship Him. Just to commune with Him. Spend time with Him. Get to know Him. Experience Him. We have to make an effort to do it. In the mornings, my wife, in preparing to get ready for her day, has started to watch Tony Evans or Joyce Meyer or something along that lines as she's getting ready to go. She's listening to words, she's listening to lessons, getting ready for her day. So much better than watching the news or Sports Center or anything else to focus on the Word and let that feed on that Word in the morning. So the other day I walked through and Tony Evans was speaking about, he made an analogy of people using prayer as a spare tire. So I'm going to borrow from that analogy and say that people use Jesus as a spare tire. We just out driving our car, go where we want to go, how fast we want to go, where we want to go. We just drive in our car. And because we don't know the roads as well as we think we do, and because we are so apt to, because of our very nature, we're going to end up on a crooked path. And that's when we get the blowout. Now we think about the spare. Now we think about the spare. Right? After we done messed up. We pop the trunk and get the spare out. We find out it's buried. It's buried beneath a lot of baggage we've been carrying around. So now we gotta start unloading these bags to even get to the spare. And these bags, they're clearly marked. They're clearly marked. You know, you got a bag of a doubt. You got bags of unbelief. Here's a bag of fear. Here's a bag of busyness. Here's a bag of sin. Here's a bag of unforgiveness. A bag of mistakes and failures from the past. A bag of idolatry. A bag of sports and entertainment media. Bag of religion, bag of relationships, bag of routine, bag of work, bag of hobbies, just name a few. But the biggest bag and the heaviest bag is the one that has self on it. What's in that bag? Ooh! That bag stinks! Push out the way to get to the spare. Okay? Then we get our spare on, back on our, we're back driving again. I'm sorry, before we start driving, we put all that stuff back in the trunk. Those same old bags. Or you could be one of those people who will say, Jesus, you go ahead and drive. I'm going to give it to you. However, I'm going to tell you where to go. I'll tell you where to go. I'll tell you where to stop. I'll tell you how fast to go. And I'll tell you how to get there. Or maybe one of those drivers will just say, take the keys, Lord. Take the steering wheel. Matter of fact, take the whole car. And you take me where you want me to go. See, I'm just happy to be here with you, Jesus. I'm just full of joy that I'm even in your presence. Take me where you want to go. Because you're Jesus. Because you have created this car. You have created every path that you're going to take me on. So you know the way. Everything that we're going to see, everything we're going to go past, you know it because you created it. So I trust you to get me where you want me to be. I mentioned earlier this, the meaning of cherith as being a cutting. And I'm going to add that. I'm going to get there, but I want to give you another quick analogy. Several years ago, due to circumstance, I ended up coaching my oldest son's boys and girls basketball team. The team was pretty good. They were pretty good. Like we had good size. We had talent. We had some decent depth. And we were one of the top teams in the league. This particular week, we were playing one of the less talented and weaker teams in the league. They were a pretty bad team, to be honest. Now, the week before, we had played and beaten another pretty good team. Matter of fact, we had beaten them decisively, blown them out. My son had his best game of the season that previous week. I think he had over 20 points. He had hit 5 or 6 three-pointers. Everybody played well that previous week. So they came to this game confident. Overconfident, to be exact. Because they came out jacking up shots from everywhere. Everybody shooting, just shooting. Doing what they want to do, shooting from everywhere. My son was shooting from distance so far, Steph Curry would have said, whoa, that's a long way to shoot a ball. I mean, bombs, everybody. Even the little kid that wouldn't shoot the ball. You know, that's always that little kid, too. You know what I'm talking about, Tamir? The one that's only on the team because you only play because you got to make him play because they paid to be on the team. That little kid, the little shy kid, he was jacking up shots. I was like, what's going on here today? It's fourth quarter. We're missing shots. We're turning the ball over. Not playing good defense. And this inferior team is beating us. First quarter, we're down by about 10 points because we're playing selfish. Got parents screaming at me behind the bench because parents always know what's best, right? Yeah. Get a timeout, coach. Get a timeout. I'm just sitting there. I'm watching. Another missed shot. They come out and score. Another silly foul. Give them a free throw. Down by 13 points into the second quarter. To an inferior team. And by this point, I made sure I got everybody into the game to get a little playing time. And everybody I put in did the same thing. It was selfish. It was an amazing thing to see. Timeout. Bring your kids together, not yelling, not screaming. Okay. I tell them, look at the scoreboard. We're behind. I said, all of you have done things the way you want to do them. And now we're playing from behind. Just run the play. Sometimes we gotta get away from the game. We gotta take a time out. And we need time to rest and be focused and get instruction and strategize. And sometimes we just give the team too much credit. We're the better team, but we're giving too much credit because they're winning. The only reason they're winning is because we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing. We're behind it because we're playing the way we want to play instead of running the play that has been called. God hasn't given us the playbook. Do we study it? Do we even know the plays? He's given us His Holy Spirit to teach us the plays and to assist us in running the plays. When we try to run the plays on our own, we will constantly find ourselves out of position and not contributing to the team and the team's success the way we should be. Acts 1:8 says, but you shall receive power. That's ability, efficiency, and might when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. We all have this power, this ability, this efficiency, and this might. In the 10th chapter of Luke, Jesus sent the 70 out. Remember, He said, I send you out like sheep along. Among wolves, and take no bag. If they don't receive you, wipe your feet, wipe dust from your feet. But when they came back, they returned with joy, saying, Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. And Jesus says, behold, I have given you authority and power to trample upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power that the enemy possesses. And nothing shall in no way harm you. Power. That's exciting stuff. We have power over the enemy. That's exciting stuff. Then Jesus said, nevertheless, do not rejoice at this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rejoice that your names are
written in heaven. See, we rejoice in the victory. Jesus gave us the victory. He gave us the power over that. We rejoice in that as well. We should. And we should walk in the power and the authority that's been given us. But he says it's a greater thing. It's a greater thing to rejoice about. And that's because we're on the team. We rejoice in the relationship we have with the Father. We rejoice that we can be with the Father. We rejoice that we can be with the Lord. We want to use our power not like it should be used. It says, if the power of the demons was good news and cause for rejoicing, your salvation is even better news, and it's the cause for your deepest joy. The joy of the Christian, our joy, should not become primarily because of the destruction of Satan's hold and power over us, but in the fact that we have not belonged to God. We rejoice because we belong to God. We rejoice because we are His, not just because of the victory. There's joy in serving God. There's joy in being used by God. But the deepest joy is our relationship with Him. That's what we kind of lose sight of that. Our deepest joy is our relationship with Him. Once again, we have to get along with God. We have to get to know Him and love Him and to develop a dependence on Him. That's why we need a cherith place. The cherith brook. The place where you're completely cut off and totally dependent upon God and His resources. Cherith. We need a cherith place. We need a cutting. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to take away, to cut away anything that hinders us from growing in our relationship with God. So let's just run the play. That's all we got to do. Just run the play. So many people wondering, what's my call? What's my purpose? Why am I here? You don't have to call so many hundred numbers. You don't have to seek no psychic. You don't have to read the horoscopes. You don't have to climb some mountain and ask some guru on top of the mountain, why am I here? Spend time with God. Develop your relationship with Him. Let Him order your steps. Let Him lead you. Let Him tell you what He wants you to do and where He wants you to be. One of the Pharisees asked Jesus, said, Master, which is the greatest commandment? Jesus said, you should love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy soul, with all thy might. We talked about that in Sunday school. It's so simple. It's so simple. Are we there? And what's keeping us from being there? We need to spend time in cherith brook. We need something to be cut away. Those things that keep us from putting God first. God spoke and Elijah went. He went to cherith brook. And he went not having any idea how long he was going to be there. What would your response be? Would you question God? Why are you sending me out there in the middle of nowhere, God? How long am I going to be there, God? Why do you want me there? I'll go, Lord, but you know, the game come on at 4 o'clock, and you know, that's my team. That's my team. I'd like to tell you just how long for sure Elijah was at the brook, but I don't know for sure. But some commentators believe it was 2 years. 2 years. What about my mortgage? What about my job? What about my season tickets? I missed two seasons of American Idol. Quick question. What wouldn't you give up to grow in the Lord? What wouldn't you give up to grow in the Lord? We got to remember, it's not what you give up, it's what you gain. But what would you not give up to grow in the Lord? If anything came to mind when I asked that question, or if it comes to mind later on, that's what we should be down to the cross and handing over to Him. Because the truth is all His anyway. It's all His anyway. Your family, your wife, your kids, your relationship, what would you give up to grow in the Lord? Jehovah Jireh, my provider. We know that one. He does provide. God will provide. He does. He does. Do we want Him to provide how we want Him to provide? Or how He wants to provide? See, it's a miracle just how God provided for Elijah out here to care fruit. The thought of eating meat that the ravens brought us. Some people are like, those birds, those dirty birds touch that meat and that's what I gotta eat. Listen, y'all. I'd rather eat meat that was directed by the Lord to be sat in front of me than to eat some of the meals at these restaurants that sat in front of me. You don't know what's going back in that kitchen, right? You know, and the sign of the restroom says, you know, employees must wash hands after using, but we know people don't always do what they're supposed to do. You know, pray over your food. Pray over your food. Out in a desolate place, middle of nowhere, God still provides for Elijah. Bread and meat in the morning, bread and meat in the evening. What an awesome God. I was thinking if that was me, wouldn't it be a wonderful thing if it was bread and crab cakes in the morning and bread and crab cakes in the evening for me? That would be beautiful. But that's just an example of how we want God to provide for us instead of being thankful for what He provides for us in His way. We should be thankful and appreciative of God's providing and provisions and what He chooses to provide. Okay? Once again, Cherith Brook is to bring us to complete dependence on Him and His provision. If God didn't direct the ravens to bring the food, you don't eat. Plain and simple. There's no options out there. That's what we need to be. There are no other options than what God has for us. Total dependence on Him. Even when the brook dries up, we are still to trust and depend on God. Elijah didn't go looking for another brook. He stayed right where he was at, knowing that the Lord would provide. Psalm 27:14 says, wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and He shall strengthen thy heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Do we sure have a tendency to want things done or have what we want in our time, in our way? That's what we cherish, bro, to chip away our wants and our desires from us. That's how we should be giving the Holy Spirit permission to shape us and mold us into what He wants us to be. Through the Holy Spirit permission to take away anything and everything that is not of us. Why don't you spend time at Cherub Brook? Once you come to solely depend on God and His provisions, once you remove all your desires, once we have inclined our ears and hearts to hear His voice, then praise God. We are, one thing we have to understand about, as you read on in this story, God's ways are not our ways. So He has to prepare you for service, because He may send you someplace you're not expecting, okay? The widow was in a desperate situation. She was preparing her last meal. She's praying to die. So God may put you, it's amazing. God will orchestrate people to come into your life at a certain time, but you have to spend time in chair to be prepared for that meeting and be so in tune with God and what He has said that you can say the Lord says to that person, because you can make a difference in someone's life. The doors of the church are open. If anyone wants to come up and, you know, lean to the cross, it's that option is there for you. It's always there for you. At any time you can lay something down to the cross, that's the cross. At any time you give anything to Jesus. If there's anyone in need of special prayer, we have people in position to pray with you and for you. For our internet audience that may be joining us, we thank you for joining us this today, and we invite you to come back next week. God bless you.